oxygen less than about 5 mg/L. Anoxia is zero dissolved oxygen. And we can see in the world map, these are all dots reflecting different areas of oxygen stress around the world. So it's something that's global, but this is varying severity. The worst ones are completely anoxic, they're called dead zones. And the areas where organisms can no longer live, including places like the Gulf of Mexico and offshore of Oregon. So one such oxygen stressed area in the Northwest is Hood Canal. It's experienced chronic hypoxia since about the 1950s, and in recent years it's gotten so bad in the southern end that there have been fish kills. Part of the reason for this is its shape. It's very long and narrow, and there's only this single little outlet to Puget Sound. So water flushes, it's very poorly flushed. It takes a long time for water to move through it. And so once the water that's in there gets oxygen depleted, it stays depleted for a long time. So now I'm going to talk a little bit more about the biology behind the oxygen cycle. When there's light and nitrogen, generally in the summer months, phytoplankton can bloom. And they're photosynthetic, so they're going to create some dissolved oxygen. Then when they start to die, marine bacteria will come in, decompose the phytoplankton, and use some of the oxygen that's been produced. Now this is a normal process that occurs pretty much everywhere, but where it gets to be a problem is when the nitrogen gets somehow increased, which causes the phytoplankton blooms to be vastly increased, causing the bacteria to be increased, which then depletes the oxygen beyond what's healthy for the ecosystem. So the overall question is, what causes Hood Canal to become hypoxic or anoxic? And my specific part of it is, how does marine bacterial community composition vary with that dissolved oxygen levels that we find in Hood Canal? So we sample every couple of months over a period of about 3 years, taking samples for dissolved oxygen, nutrients, bacterial abundance, and also bacterial community, which I'll be talking in more depth in a couple of slides. So here's some environmental data. I realize this might be a little difficult to see some of the contour lines. But this data comes from Hama Hama, which is a station about in the middle, north to south of Hood Canal. This is the deepest station, it's about 160 meters, and does never get too stressed one way or another in terms of oxygen. So it's a good kind of good station to look at. So these plots are showing date, June 06 to June 08 on the x-axis versus depth. And the color in the top plot is dissolved oxygen, milligrams per liter. Put kind of a danger bar here just below 5 mg to show where the stress is occurring. And so the first thing I want to notice, you can notice, is the seasonality. It goes over several years, so you can see seasonal differences between kind of going vertical chunks across to the right. It looks high and then low and then high and then low. But the other thing that I have on there is the contour line overlays are nitrate, which is the nutrient that the phytoplankton are going to be using. And so if you can see, right here is a period of high nitrate, and it's going to be followed by high DO, and the link there is the phytoplankton photosynthesizing, using the nitrate, creating the dissolved oxygen. On the bottom plot, I have bacterial abundance counts, and then the overlay is actually the same dissolved oxygen data from the top plot. And what we see here is the same kind of seasonality. And then we also are showing where there's high dissolved oxygen, shortly after there's high bacterial abundance, and then shortly following that, there's very low dissolved oxygen, which speaks to the biological model that I was talking about earlier. So Sisters Point is a southern station, which shows a much different picture. It's only about 60 meters deep, so it's not very shallow, and it's farther toward the south, which means it gets more poorly mixed. So what we can first notice here is, again, the seasonality, again, the biological connections between nitrate and dissolved oxygen, between dissolved oxygen and bacterial abundance. But really, just everything is more extreme. Whereas on the previous plot, more greens here at depth, which are pretty safe. Here we've got a huge patch of purple, which is anoxic. There's no oxygen there. And then a period, while there may not be a fish kill here, that's definitely going to be stressful for the organisms living there. So just a real quick side-by-side to see how very different they are, and noted the fish kill that occurred here, and then at the same time, there's not as much stress going on for Hamma Hamma, and there's no fish dying at Hamma Hamma. So my bacterial community data results in a DNA fingerprint that we can compare between many different samples to look at peaks that may be present in one and absent in another, to just look at how the communities stack up against one another. So these are just two very different fingerprints that we would look at. And from that, from many different samples, we can get relatedness data. So what this is showing, there's no axes, it's showing relatedness between each sample. Each point is a sample. Closer together means they're more related, farther apart means they're less related. You can color code them for various different things. So what I've colored them for here is to show station. Now, when we talk about Hamma Hamma being very, very different from Sisters Point, you might think that there would be some kind of correlation by station, that certain stations, their communities would look similar. But surprisingly, we find that they're not. There's no statistical significance correlating station to the bacterial communities. In fact, it's no better than random. And then we can color code the exact same points, the same relatedness by year. And from there, we can see that there's definitely much bigger clusters and much more statistical significance. On one side, we've got almost all of 2006. On the other side, 2007 and 2008. They're clustering much more tightly. And what we think this is saying is that no matter the depth, the station, or the season, within a given year, the communities or the samples from that year are more like each other than they are to other years, regardless of those other factors, which is actually quite surprising. And then we can look at it color-coded another way on oxygen. Not quite as striking a trend, but it still is statistically significant where the stations that we had lumped over here are generally lower oxygen, which we know from looking at the environmental data, and over here are generally higher oxygen. So communities in low oxygen and high oxygen samples, within those clusters, there is some statistical significance there. All right, so I don't want to go too in-depth in this, but this is another view of relatedness. We still see some of the same kind of clusters, and these tend to be the same samples that you were looking at on the other plot. And then overlaid with some water property values. And then what we've also got on here are OTUs, which are operational taxonomic units. So those are going to correlate to those peaks that I showed you in the DNA fingerprinting. And it's showing relatedness between the OTUs to each other and to the sites where they were found. So this leads me to some possible future questions, such as, are there specific OTUs that are present regardless of the oxygen concentration, so something that's there all the time? Are there unique OTUs that are found in high oxygen years, something like, well, high for Hood Canal, something like 2007? And then most interestingly to me, are there unique OTUs that correlate with extreme hypoxic or anoxic events? And if we find something like that, that could be an interesting pathway to follow up, to kind of see what the bacteria is doing at an ecological level. Thank you. Yeah, I think so. And then fall.